a driving guitar song. Creedence used to write a lot of songs in the key of D, which is a very up-sounding key. It's a bright, vibrant-sounding key, which is great for guitars, particularly in the way they use them. It's a really simple song, and aside from the chords in the intro, it's based around two or three chords.
So you've got an intro, which basically goes like this, and they're all major chords, which is quite interesting as well. There's no minor chords in this intro at all. So basically the chords there are C major to A major, C major to A major, C major to A major to G major to F major to D major. Then the main verse is just over one chord, the chord of D major. And that's it. And there's a little bridge that takes you up to the chorus, which is A major to B minor to the chorus, which is back to the D. Rolling on a river. And the strange thing about it is, I think other songwriters might change the chords to fit the melody, but he doesn't bother. And in essence, you don't need to.
Riff was reminiscent of the paddle wheeler rotating, and it was just amazing how this thing worked.
It was unique. Nothing sounded like that song at the time, and while it didn't become a number one hit, it got close. It was a number two hit in 1969, and I think because it was unique, nothing sounded like it.
Really strong, original composition. John's first big classic. You know, I mean, the song has gone on. Be recorded by, you know, must be over 100 people, maybe 200 by now. Rolling, rolling on the hill. We are real confident that Bayou Country was a noticeable, you know, leap in the band's growth. John's growth as a writer, our improvement as ensemble players. We're really happy with it. It had a great sound, a big fat sound. Probably our best sounding album. Keep on shooting. Keep on shooting. Keep on shooting.
Keep on Tugling was very hypnotic, all built around about one or two notes, a very simple bass line and a rhythm guitar pulse, really. Some people reacted quite badly to it, and other people became obsessed by it. It's like one of those numbers that you don't want to stop. Keep on Tugling. Keep on
Tugling. 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 Keep on Chuglin was just a typical, straightforward John Fogerty rant that was fun. I mean, CCR songs didn't have to mean a whole lot, didn't have to be deep.
When you first hear it, you think, oh, here we go again, another sort of swamp vamp around one chord, which essentially it is. But actually, what they do with it, by introducing, you know, harmonica, some just slightly more unusual sort of blues licks, something that you can really tell they're having fun, and that's why it works.
Again, it's about as much fun as you can have with one chord. The soloing reminds me very much of Neil Young, in that it's not always spot on. There's the odds sour note in there, if you like, but it doesn't seem to matter because it's delivered with amazing fire. Yeah.
Bayou Country was, I think, played live in its entirety for weeks and weeks and weeks before we ever went into the studio. So these songs were songs that we were so in command of, so on top of, that, you know, we owned this material.
The name of the album, these guys played up on the rumor that they were from Louisiana and the Bayou, and the styles that this band could pull off from Louisiana, Tex-Mex, Bayou, swamp, blues, rock, pop, Americana storytelling, was just quite fascinating. I think these guys had quite the chuckle because they're all from the West Coast and, you know, out of San Francisco, and everybody thought that they were from the Bayou.
Born on the Bayou is an odd song, really, for a San Francisco band or a West Coast band. Back at that time, everyone was into love, peace, and flower power. There was all of this psychedelic stuff that was coming out of the West Coast of America. And yet here comes Creedence Clearwater Revival singing about almost a voodoo, swampy, dark deeds kind of song. That whole image of the Deep South. I mean, I can't hear Born on the Bayou without fancying some Cajun food. It really is as simple as that.
When we started getting more and more of our own voice, it sounded more like the South, which is where the music we love came from. You know, be it white guys singing the blues or black guys singing the blues. You know. And so, you know, we didn't really have any first-hand experience with the South. And so we just kind of took it from the music and the stories and the style of playing and kind of imagined all the rest of it.
When you listen to a certain genre of music and you start picking up the nuances in the music and then start, you know, incorporating it into your own sound, it's definitely going to come out. And I think, you know, when you listen to it, most CCR songs, you really get this feel of the Deep South and kind of spooky, moody, swampy type music.
The first time we went to the South, we were in Louisiana, and I think we were in Baton Rouge, which is the state capital. We tried to check into our hotel room, and the guy, they wouldn't let us check in because we had long hair. So that it was like they didn't think we were from the South. They knew darn well we were from San Francisco.
Well, Green River was actually an interesting album because it had much more of a rock sort of feel to it, I suppose, epitomized by Commotion, which is a sort of song that sums up urban angst. I think they got back to the big city on that one, away from the bayou. And although it does have a kind of Red Indian Warpath drum introduction.
Certainly the track Commotion, which is actually played in E, but detuned down a tone to D, that huge dark sound from the guitars, it was a heavy rock track virtually. But I think they'd always suggested being a rock band from before then.
What they were listening to, you know, the British invasion, for instance, that was coming in, even the Beatles were quite tough in their earlier records. I think they were just trying to get a little bit of that into their sound.
In a lot of ways, the English invasion was a great eye-opener for American musicians because they just took American music and threw it back at us. So when people like John Mayall, would be presented such a hard, and the Yardbirds, and all these guys, such a hardcore American music, with a little bit of a spin on it, but boy, was it, they're more true to it than American players have become.
Green River was more of a rock album as opposed to their first album. And I think, I think at the time a lot of the songs, a lot of them were sort of set up because they were getting a bit of success with AM radio. So they were thinking, okay, let's make some of our songs 3 minutes long as opposed to 6 or 7 minutes long or 5 minutes long. So I think that was a big push for that album.
I don't think of CCR as a sellout to any degree. I mean, they were a band who wrote great songs you could sing along to.
Green River was archetypal Creedence to me, the bayou feeling again, the Cajun feeling. But then you have songs like Lodi, which is John Fogerty's love song about, I think it was about him being on the road and away from this particular lady, is a fantastic rock ballad.
Just about a year ago, I set out on the road, seeking my fame and fortune, looking for a pot of gold. Things got bad and things got worse, I guess you know the tune.
At that time, these guys were putting out albums, three of them almost in a year. I mean, now, that's unheard of, absolutely unheard of. So you can tell the progression of this band musically from album to album in a matter of months, from into the studio, commercially successful on the radio, touring live shows, back in the studio, writing on the road or wherever it happens to be, and again, flexing their muscles every time they go back into the studio, cranking it up another notch.
Green River was a good album. They were very prolific at that time. They seemed to be producing an album every few months, and under great pressure as well, of course, to come up with more hits. And Bad Moon Rising was one of the tracks on that album, and of course that was one of their biggest hits.
Bad Moon Rising was our first number one hit in England, and a simple country tune, a rockabilly type tune, and just one note on the bass. Dun, 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 dun.
The song basically is based around three chords, which is the chord of D major, A major, and G major. That's the whole song. It's just moved around in different ways. So the main body of the song goes like this. Then there's another little section, because there's two guitar players in the band. One guitar player is playing that, and the other guitar player, every time he gets back to the D major chord, is playing. Which is a real country lick. A great little lick, actually. It's very simple, but really effective. One of the strengths of Creedence Clearwater Revival, just picking out the right little licks for the song.
Fogerty's voice on Bad Moon Rising is actually like a musical instrument. It's actually quite a musical sounding voice, and the way the track builds is just total simplicity. Just the little guitar licks in the second verse. Doesn't need anything more than that. No kitchen sink. Just, again, Tom Fogerty's relentless rhythm guitar.
It's contemporary performance, and yet it had that feel for 50s rock and roll. Lots of echo and driving drums, and great piece of work.
Bad Moon Rising, musical highlight of that album?
For me it is, I know. And we've all heard this in a variety of films over the years, and you'll want to either run out and grab the album or throw it back on your CD player or call the radio station you want to hear that, or you want to go and rent the movie again. It's such a great song.
I know that when John Fogerty wrote that song, he'd read about this story about a fellow who made a pact with the devil, and then this hurricane went through the valley, and only his farm, all the grain was still standing. And you know, he thought, well, this is an interesting thing, you know, and hearing the phrase, like, I think there's going to be a bad moon arising, you know, just taking a little simple phrase like that and building this whole sort of song on it.
We're talking about voodoo and some dark deeds at night and lyrics like, I hope you're prepared to die, and yet it makes you smile. There was a vitality and humour in his voice that managed to lift you, even in some of his darkest lyrics.
When that song was number one in England, we had a little celebration down at the record company, and a little champagne toast, and Doug and I proceeded to head out on the road and get into a car, motorcycle, and a third party. We were all involved in an accident together, and his Porsche was totaled, my motorcycle was totaled, and I was on crutches for about a week, but no serious damage, but, gotta watch out for those celebrations. Can't get too excited about these things.